Ici Monte Carlo, onde moyenne 205 mètres. Nos émissions sont maintenant terminées. Bonne nuit, mesdames. Bonne nuit, mesdemoiselles. Bonne nuit, messieurs.
This is Radio Geronimo.
If someone could say, which year would you like to have had a free, completely free progressive radio show, a radio program, that would have probably been one of the best years.
Geronimo on 205 with Ferris Sanders and a track called Umala, Umala, Umala.
Geronimo was about, you know, was about subordinating the DJ. Was getting rid of the fucking DJ format.
Your electric alternative, broadcasting to you from Monte Carlo.
We were free, you know, it was the station was free. I mean, it was broadcasting in Monte Carlo and we were doing the shows in London, so we didn't have anyone really sort of tapping us on the shoulder.
It was very, more a hippie setup than a business setup.
Geronimo was called Geronimo because that's what they used to shout when they threw themselves out of an aeroplane. And also, you know, he was a bit of a rebel as an Indian chief, and we quite liked that.
This is Radio Geronimo, broadcasting on 205 metres in the medium wave from the transmitters of Radio Monte Carlo each Friday, Saturday and Sunday. I'm Hugh, how are you?
We're about 1,300 metres above sea level here, and we're actually standing on French territory above Monaco and Monte Carlo. And I guess I was 14 when I first stumbled across Radio Geronimo, 205 metres next to Luxembourg on 208. I guess Geronimo has been lost in radio history because certainly it doesn't have the romance of the pirate radio stations. It was neither at sea nor was it illegal, and that's amazing to think that Geronimo was completely legal despite the profanities, the radical thoughts and the very radical music. There's never been anything as probably as adventurous or as ambitious as Geronimo was.
I had a radio scan through and just came across Geronimo, very close to Radio Luxembourg. A lot quieter, so more difficult to listen to, but the music was amazing.
Tuning the dial backwards and forwards and not knowing what it was, and then found the station playing this quite eclectic mix of interesting stuff was called Radio Geronimo 1 Harley Street. Send us some money, buy this. We sell records, we're nice people.
You can segue Albert Ayler and Bach. You can segue Judy Collins and the Grateful Dead. You can segue music from Marley and music from Albert Ayler, or from Timbuktu and Wapping High Street. That's confrontation. There's an edge.
You can take people places that they haven't been before. You say, hey, listen to this. And they think, wow. Yes. Oh, that's classical music, isn't it? Yeah, it's good too. Never knew that. And there's loads of them. You know, we did sell this stuff. You know, the Buxtehude albums. You know, to teenagers.
Hello, this is Geronimo on 205, bringing you summer sunshine all the way from Monte Carlo. My name's Hugh, and this is a test broadcast for the purpose of judging reception. And I'd like you to hear Lionel Rogg playing the Giacona in E minor by Buxtehude.
I've never met such a scoundrel as Tony Secunda. You know, it's a ex-wrestling and boxing promoter who managed the move.
What you get with people like Tony Secunda is you get this very, very intense, very, very bright, manipulative human being.
What a guy. Sadly, he's not with us anymore, although I'm probably one of the few who say sadly. But he was a dynamite guy. Tony going around collecting all the cash and putting it in a big bag. It was really old school rock and roll. You know, I sort of got a taste for it, I guess, then.
Jimi was very gentle, and he was managed by this vicious... I think Tony was Maltese, but he definitely had that kind of He certainly had nightclub pale. He had that. He definitely had a kind of gambler's tan.
This is dedicated to Tony and Jimi, and the only reason we're on the air really is due to Mr. S and Mr. M. So we can dedicate this to them. This is a track called "Gotta Get Ourselves Together" by Delaney and Bonnie.
Why do we all sound gay? My kids are absolutely convinced that what they're hearing is a screaming homosexual. Of course, I try to deny that. But we all sounded very, very camp. We all sounded like Marc Bolan. It was amazing. You know, it was very kind of that, you know. Don't be heavy, man, you know.
And this is Geronimo on 205 metres in the medium wave band. And if you want to buy that record, or indeed any other, then buy it from us and not from the shops, man, because that's how we stay on the air.
He was definitely an out-and-out flower child, without any... I mean, he had everything. I was very Stalinist, you know, very left-wing Jewish, very right-on. Wasn't really into the drug scene, although I was, you know,
He had this Rupert Bear obsession. All of his notes, he used it like a kind of briefcase, or like other people use a briefcase, or latterly a file of facts or whatever. So all his notes would be slotted into a copy, an old Rupert Bear annual. And indeed, one of the early names of Radio Geronimo was indeed Radio Rupert.
Yeah, I mean, what? Just lie on the family stone. Really nice. Sorry to make you sit through such an epic, but that's part of our thing, you see, is not to just play short tracks all the time, but to play, you know, if they're long and they need playing in their entirety, then by God, we'll play them.
But that was Hugh Nolan. I mean, Hugh was really into all that. Captain Beefheart, Frank Zappa, Jefferson Airplane, anything with a drug in it.
So if you just send along 12 and 6 weeks to Geronimo at 1 Harley Street, London West 1, you can get yourself a cheese pretty quick, straight away in fact. But if you don't, as I hear from Geronimo, I swear I'll just come down and I'll fucking kill you.
We didn't have any censorship, and it was the joyous time where you could speak your mind. We used to do things for the Vietnam draft dodgers. You know, we'd help them link up and find places to go. I mean, we were quite radical in our politics. I wouldn't say we were left, right or centre. We were just anarchists, crazy, free-loving hippies, you know.
And we have to go now, but tune in tomorrow night at midnight on 205 Middies, or even better, see you down at Fun City. So take care, have a beautiful day tomorrow, and God bless.
So it's Fun City.
Oh, yeah,
which is the most memorable festival ever. It was a mixture of the IT Oz guys all getting together, deciding to have a festival in Sussex, and the headline band was the MC5. Radio Geronimo was very much involved. In fact, we actually published a newspaper on site.
All the hippies lived in the woods. And there were rockers there as well. So the hippies used to hoot at night, tearing the woods apart, and the rockers used to tear around the arena on their motorbikes.
A fantastic festival, met a lot of great Americans, came over. It was very much a meeting of the sort of white panthers of America and the sort of wild hippie anarchists of England all getting together in one place. The Pink Fairies played there. I can't remember much more of the bill, to be honest, because it was again very, very hazy, and it was very, very free, and I think we all lost money, but we had a great time.
And did you know that Geronimo is the only place in the world where you can get cigarette papers which are well over a foot long in length? We are selling them for 2 shillings a packet, and this...
We used to sell these enormous cigarette papers, and they actually... Well, they came in packets first of all, and then they started coming in drums about that wide. So we had to start trying to devise ways of cutting these up. Nothing really worked. So I think we finished up doing it with scissors.
You want a man? That's the Jimi Hendrix Experience. Jimi Hendrix guitar, Neil Redding on bass, Mitch Mitchell drums, and that's a recording that was done at the Montreal International Pop Festival.
The BBC jammed us, and so we were sitting around our listeners in the southern England couldn't get us. This station in Folkestone was moving their signal into ours just enough to hinder it. So we wrote to the BBC, they said absolutely no, they weren't doing anything, but we were getting nowhere with them. So we decided that we'd jam them back. And so we bought 18 pounds of strawberry jam, and Hugh and I and Tony and the rest of the guys went. We alerted the press, of course, and went down to Broadcasting House and threw jam all over the place. And we got arrested. When the cops threw us in the back of the squad car, they realised we were covered in jam, threw us back out again, and made us wait for a paddy wagon. And we had a pleasant night in jail.
I come straight to the point tonight because what we need from you is direct support, direct involvement and direct action, which you can do by helping us get advertising, which is the most important thing we need at the moment, which means bread.
I remember Tony Secunda confronted me in the office in Harley Street and said that if I didn't make my programmes more commercial, then I'd have to leave. But I had no compunction. I certainly wasn't going to compromise the integrity of my programmes.
I'm going to play a track now from an album called Lotus Lantern, and this is played by the Chinese Classical Orchestra. And this music came from one of the famous Kung Chu acts, a type of drama which bloomed in the Yuan Dynasty, I'm reading it, AD 1206-1341, and became very popular during the Ming Dynasty and Qing Dynasty.
You know, there's varying degrees of desperation. Mostly it's put over by Hugh, who could do it in the quite funny sort of way of saying, we need your money, you know, you must join, you know, this is not going to last.
And the time has come when Geronimo has got to take some advertisements. In fact, we need to take some advertisements if we don't go off the air sharpish.
Yeah!
Had we got ahead with what Richard Branson wanted to get involved with us on the business side, but Tony Secunda and Jimmy Miller wouldn't have it at all, I thought it was quite a good idea, and in retrospect, it was probably a bloody good idea. Richard went, can I get involved in your distribution? And we told him to piss off, you capitalist bastard, you know, we're hippies to the end, you know. Foolishly.
That whole sort of area, in that, on one part they wanted to say, you know, up the establishment, we don't need you, you know, we're going to do our own thing and we're not going to take adverts and we're pure and wonderful. And the other one was, this is costing us rather a lot of money.
When it came off, yeah, we were probably just shocked more than anything at the time. I mean, it's just something, now it's there, now it isn't. What do you do?
You know, we had this vision of it always, of getting back. I mean, Hugh and I, again, tried in our way to do it, but we just weren't, well, we didn't have the wherewithal in those days, and we were too stoned.
If people want to learn from Radio Geronimo, then it should be doing something that's relevant today. You know, the technology's changed. Kids' patience has changed. I think people's listening habits have changed. Apart from that, I mean, the general integrity of the programme and the style of the shows are still there.
That, yeah, it was. There was something in the air, you know. And it was magic.